I remember going through the text of A Course in Miracles, and I remember looking at some of these subsection titles, and one of them was Attraction to Guilt. And I said, "That, what a title. Good thing he didn't make a pamphlet out of that, you know, like Song of Prayer, Attraction to Guilt. Can you imagine that? That's not going to be a bestseller." So I read on, and you know what's right after that? Attraction to Pain. Another one, not going to be a bestseller. This is like a tough chapter as far as looking at that. And then I read on to the next subsection, and it was Attraction to Death. And I said, that is bizarre. From an ego perspective, that seems crazy. But when I read that section, he basically said, as long as you believe in the ego, you're a death worshiper. You're literally putting value where there is no value, and you're giving that in the sense of worshiping. So when you go into A Course in Miracles, it takes you very deep into this death idea. And I think this is just getting your attention. These dear loved ones that are doing that is just pointing you to go inside even deeper to say, how am I attracted to death? Not so much how, like we've talked about, don't go on a witch hunt, don't try to figure it out or analyze it, but if you have any kind of reaction, like a sadness or a grief or anything coming up, then the way to do is go inside and give that over to the Holy Spirit, really to the core that you can, to the best of your ability, and that's really what the lesson is. It's just your own lesson.
By the way, David mentioned Eckhart Tolle earlier. I just want to tell you a quick story. I was in Vancouver, in British Columbia. I was doing a workshop there, and this guy named Dennis took me out to lunch. We're in this restaurant, and we're leaving. And you know, Vancouver has millions of people, and wouldn't it be odd, you know, Dennis says to me, "Hey, Eckhart Tolle's here." Right? That's where he lives. I said, "Ah, cool. Well, that's really great." And he says, "You want to meet him?" So I'm like, "You know him?" I said, "Oh, yeah, sure." He takes me over and introduces me to him. It's fun. You know, this medium, very nice man, very, very good guy. And, you know, he struck me as being the way that, you know, most enlightened people who you meet, just very easygoing, kind of childish in a way, you know, childlike with that wonder about them. And it was just a lot of fun meeting him. And I do this podcast every now and then with my friend Gene Bogart. He's the producer of the podcast. And there's this guy named Steven who does spoofs of our podcast. He, you know, it's not the real podcast, but he makes it sound like our podcast. Right? Our podcast is pretty popular. We're often in the top 20 at iTunes and things like that. It goes all over the world. And this guy named Steven, when he does our podcast, he imitates Eckhart Tolle, and he sounds just like him. You know, and then he'll have me saying things like, "You know, I can't understand what the hell he's talking about." You know, stuff like that. It's like really funny. And he'll have me saying all kinds of things like, "Deepak Chopra, you know, what kind of a name is that? Like, Scottish or something?" You know, stuff like that. At the end of our podcast, usually Gene closes the podcast by saying, no matter what the question, forgiveness is the answer. Wow. Right? But Stephen says, no matter what the question, Guinness is the answer. You know, have Gene saying things like, "Hey, do we have time for a couple of questions for Gare?" And I'll go, "Oh, Christ."
And if you haven't heard that, I went in there one time, and I actually got into that, what Steve had done, and it's just hilarious, because he just tries to exaggerate the things, the voices, the mannerisms, and it's just hilarious. And talk about remembering to laugh. I mean,
really?
This is how the Holy Spirit is so playful. You take something that's really, like that podcast, is very helpful around the world. People, you know, can tune in and play it whenever they want, you know, and it's just spectacular. And then you get the spoof. And you know how, like the Peter Sellers movies, you know, the outtakes sometimes are funnier than the actual movie, like being there, you know, the outtakes at the end of the movie. So if anybody hasn't been in there, I highly recommend it. I was just laughing so much at the spoofs, the impersonations.
Yeah, thank you.
I just wanted to get a little more clarification about like the discernment part. Like, okay, because I was listening to what you said. Like, so if you feel good about something, just let it go. Don't even worry about it. Like, so if, like, trying to pay attention to what's around you so that you maybe can get the signposts or the symbols to move you to the right place. So if it's a positive emotion, just let it go. And then if it's a negative emotion, that's where you need to go backwards and feel like that's some unconscious guilt that you're holding on to or whatever. So if something comes up, like, keeps repeating itself. So I was almost thinking like Bruce Almighty when he was yelling to God and he's seeing the stop signs and all the stuff and he's ignoring and crashes into the pole. You know, it was all stuff outside of him, symbols. But yet he wasn't looking, were you with the 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, you know, it doesn't mean anything. In discerning, like, just so I'm paying attention, being present, like, is there a helpful way to properly discern? You're saying just use the feelings, but if you feel good, then just ignore everything, and you're good, or?
You know, I don't know, to me, when I saw all these synchronicities and symbols, it's like I'm like the kid in the candy show, you know, or the candy store. Wow, you know, it was just, they're very helpful. So I wasn't meaning so much let it go. No, it's when the negative stuff comes up, then you let that go. But the other stuff was more thank you. One of the things that Gary and I think have been emphasizing here is that the spiritual journey can be enjoyable. You don't have to think of it as a heavy thing and then, oh, in the future you can have happy times and be enlightened. You can actually have happiness now. You can have fun right now. And to me, that's what I think of when I think of those little signs and symbols that are around me. At first, when they started happening, I was like, wow, thank you, thank you. And then it was more thank you, thank you, thank you. And then I never got complacent about it, but it was like, it reminded me of that part of the Course where miracles are natural. When they do not occur, something has gone wrong. I started to actually relax into that and say, okay, if they're natural, then I'll expect a miracle. I'm just going to ride the miracle. Kind of like an avatar, you know, where they join with the animals. There you go. And I think more than anything, it's not with Gary and I, it's not the words we're sharing, but I would think that the more you would get to know us, you would know that we actually do have fun. That when we have a humor point through us, it's really, it's more like the cosmic, or it's the Holy Spirit's humor. It's a lightness, it's a playfulness. Like we was just talking about with Eckhart, you know, there's that sense of wonder. You know, when you're childlike and you have a sense of wonder and glee, it's so natural. Imagine interviewing like a 5-year-old who is in glee, saying, can you tell me why you are so happy? And, you know, it's just a state of mind, and it's very, very natural. So I would just say thank you when you're getting those kind of symbols, and that's what I always do. I just have gratitude.
That's what I always do. I always make sure that, all right. Thank you.
Yeah, and being that way, being joyful, shapes your entire experience. It changes the things around you, your thoughts. It's like, you know, a story I like to tell. This one is Cindy's favorites. So like a 4 or 5-year-old girl, and she was eating this vanilla ice cream cone, and she was just so happy, you know, and so joyous to be eating this ice cream cone. Now, a nutritionist would tell you that that is just terrible for her. You know, it's full of sugar. You know, it's just this terrible food that she's eating. And I saw this girl and how happy and joyous she was eating this ice cream cone, and I thought, you know, there's no way that is not going to be good for her. You know, it's got to be good for her. And, you know, you look at like Dr. Emoto's work and stuff like that, you know, and you actually change the molecules of water by the way that you're thinking about them. Well, that's true with your food also. I went to the movies once, and I used to always eat these chocolate bars at the movies, and it would make my face break out. And then Arden said to me once, he said, well, why don't you try eating it without guilt? And I did, and my face stopped breaking out when I ate this chocolate. And, you know, it's like your attitude and the way that you're going through life and being what the Course calls, you know, a happy learner,